go.
There are 2.5 million AR-15s in this country already. And unless you're going to go in and get rid of those, we need to be talking holistically about school safety. We need to require every school to have a plan. We need to have them assess what they need and give them grants to give them help for what they need.
Yeah, that was Congressman Steve Stivers from Ohio talking about this whole gun debate. And, you know, realistically, short of confiscation, which is what some of these wingnuts have suggested, there are many more immediate things that are going to have to be addressed. Like, for example, the superintendent of my kid's school, of my school district, released a report today from on school safety and security with an update. It doesn't have some of the things I would like to have seen in it, but they are talking about visitor management protocols and the possibility of hiring additional school resource officers. And they're looking at these issues. Every school district in America should be doing that. That is priority number one, as far as I'm concerned. Now, what's priority number two? Well, as I've discussed here since this happened, priority number two, in my opinion, is addressing a system where somebody like a Nicholas Cruz can completely fall through the cracks of law enforcement, of the education system. All of the warning signs were either ignored or overlooked. That's got to be the next approach. Now, in talking about that, one word we throw around a lot is, you know, we need to address mental health in this country. And I got an interesting email from Brian Bauer, who is my guest right now. He's not only a counselor, but he is a consultant with H&H Health Associates here in St. Louis. Brian, welcome into the program.
Thanks for having me.
Fascinating, because the first thing you pointed out to me was, you know, you can throw around the term mental illness, but if you couldn't even give a percentage of people who commit crimes like this. It's such a tiny fraction of people who might seek help for some sort of mental illness, right?
Yeah, you're really right. And Mark, when we talk about mental illness, the definition is so broad. It's a wide range of mental health conditions and disorders that affect your mood, thinking, and behavior. And that can be anything from depression, anxiety. It can even be ADHD. So are we trying to take guns away from people that struggle with ADHD now? What does that look like? And when you look at the numbers, about 20%, a little under 20% of Americans suffer what we call a mental health issue in a given year. Beyond that, about 4% of Americans suffer from what we consider a serious mental health issue, which is going to be things like schizophrenia, bipolar, psychosis, things like that. And it's even a very, very small percentage of that 4% that actually commit violent crimes.
I would think. I mean, yeah. So really you've whittled it down there to, I mean, it strikes me that if we can narrow it down that much, even though you still can't say that this is what caused this shooting or this is what caused, you know, Nicholas Cruz or Adam Lanza to completely take leave of their senses and commit atrocious murders. What does it do in the mental health treatment community? What are the discussions there about do you talk about what warning signs to look for?
Sure, there's warning signs. And people in mental health is all over the political spectrum as anywhere.
Sure.
I'm kind of an outlier. I'm a conservative, and I own guns, and I enjoy guns. I don't think they're evil. But there are a lot of counselors and mental health people that are towards the more liberal slant. I think we throw this around. I think the core issue for counselors, doctors, nurses, whoever it is working with psychiatric patients is twofold. Number one, nobody can predict human behavior. So there's actually a psychologist that came out of Harvard that did a study a few years ago, and he even said himself, psychologists are no better in predicting violent acts or behaviors than the normal person on the street. So we can't predict that. But I think that the second core issue is really, what can we really do about it? I can't involuntarily put someone in the hospital. That's very, very difficult to do in 2018.
Yeah, you know, we've all read the reports. The newspapers have covered them pretty extensively. In some cases, the television media about how many police visits there were to this kid's house.
Sure.
About the the difficulties the school district had. Apparently, they had a policy that was designed to keep kids out of the criminal justice system. So as a result, some fights, the fact that he brought a weapon to school one time didn't throw him into the criminal justice system. They decided to deal with it internally. I mean, I know there are a lot of issues here. You hear that his mother had him in some sort of counseling mm-hmm. before she died.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how. We had a police officer call in the other day who said that the law in Missouri anyway is if he goes into a situation and they decide to submit somebody for a mental health evaluation, mm-hmm. he has the authority to take their guns away. Is it the same way for a counselor? If somebody, I'm not asking you to violate yeah. anything because we're yeah. not talking about specifics, but if a parent comes to you with a child who's exhibiting some of these behaviors, mm-hmm. what are your limitations?
They're great. And usually the parents are more of the problem than the kids. So there are a lot of limitations. I can only suggest or write an affidavit for somebody to be hospitalized. Quite often I have to call the police, and thankfully in Sunset Hills, we got great police officers there that help us and they get the people in the hospital, but that's not the case all the time. So I have no less than three times been in a local hospital here with a signed affidavit with somebody totally psychotic and or suicidal, and the hospital refuses to admit the person. So this runs deep on a lot of different levels. This is very, very complicated in a lot of different levels in different areas.
So again, we're talking to Brian Bauer, my guest today, who's a counselor. Let's hypothetically say Brian was king for a day. What changes do you think need to be made to some of these laws so that we're not trampling on anybody's rights, but sure. but realistically we have the ability to address something if in the estimation of a professional like yourself, somebody poses a threat, we should be able to do something about that.
Yeah, it really should. And again, Mark, we're blessed in Sunset Hills to have really good police officers that help us through that process. And I know that a lot of those guys, and I see a lot of police officers, are very overworked. They can't get to all the calls, especially in the city. A lot of my clients that are city police officers, they can't get to them all. It's very difficult. But it really comes down to, and I heard Brian Kilmeade and Kennedy sparring on the air earlier. It really comes down to these things have got to be documented. If the police are not, or if the counselors are not doing the affidavits and doing things like that, then nothing is documented to be able to go back and hold these people accountable and make sure that they and their family and friends and neighbors and schools are safe.
But historically, how many years you've been in the business?
About 20 years.
So historically, weren't there some changes in the approach to mental health treatment
sure.
a number of years ago, and maybe we took it a little bit too far and made it a little too hard to
Absolutely.
Get somebody help?
Absolutely. So back in the 30s, 40s, 50s, it was very easy to commit someone. And that was probably overused in a lot of instances. But I think we've overcorrected. We've overcorrected to a point where it is very difficult to get anybody into the hospital. They're supposed to do a 96-hour hold. They don't always do that. If somebody tells me that they're going to hurt themselves or other people, and if I call the police, and if they don't say that to the police officer, then the police are handcuffed. They have to hear it firsthand. So we've got to have a larger conversation about what do we do for these people? What does that look like? I don't want to abuse any body's rights at all. But when somebody is actively psychotic, if they're bipolar or schizophrenic, and they think that they're Jesus, and they think that they have a direct access to God, and God's telling them to do these things, we've got to get those people help. And they're not going to decide to get help themselves.
And earlier this week, I played an interview with a mother who had a child around the time of the shooting in Sandy Hook. And he threatened her with a knife because
yeah.
she told him to change pants or something.
Yep.
She took him to the hospital, and by the time she got to the hospital and they got him admitted, he had calmed down,
mm-hmm.
and they released him.
That's exactly right. And Mark, one of the instances where I was at the local hospital, I literally gave the affidavit to the charge nurse. I pleaded with her for them to admit this young man. And literally by the time I got to my car, he was walking out of the side door. So big issue.
That a hospital issue, or was that specific to that health system? I mean, I imagine insurance could play a role in this at some point, right?
Well, sure, but they didn't have time to call the insurance at that point. So is that a institution? I don't know that it's the institution. Is it the charge nurse? Possibly. Maybe they didn't want to deal with it. You know, a lot of times mm-hmm. people throw their hands up and they don't want to deal with these folks. But again, our hands are tied. Family members' hands are tied.
It's a complicated issue. Again, my guest, Brian Bauer, who's a counselor here. He's got an office down in Sunset Hills. Let me take a phone call real quick. Larry, you're on the radio.
Yes, sir. Thanks for taking my call.
Yes, sir.
I think we need a major paradigm shift in the way we deal with problems. Instead of always dealing with the symptom, go to the basic problem. And I think that the problem is that going to see a counselor labels you as crazy. So if we start in, say, third grade with mandatory counseling sessions, maybe just twice a year, kids get used to talking to counselors. Everybody gets used to seeing them going in and out and not, oh, he must be crazy. He's going to see a counselor. Maybe we can start there. And then also schools need to have living programs as far as conflict resolution and resentment and anger management treatment and stuff like that. We need to start really early and start giving kids life skills nowadays. They have no life skills. By the time they're in high school and college, they're ready to kill anybody just because they stole their girlfriend or something.
Yeah, the life coping skills, I understand that one completely. Larry, thank you. Any reaction to that, Brian?
You know, a friend of mine actually sent me a bumper sticker. It's a quote from Frederick Douglass. It says, "It's easier to build strong children than to repair broken men." So he's on to something there. It's not a bad thing to see a counselor. A lot of people do it just to be able to work through the stress and relationship issues. So it's not a bad thing to do that.
But then you also face the optics of it, right?
Sure, and
you got to get people. You'd have to get people accustomed to that.
Absolutely.
Then you'd have to have enough counselors to talk to everyone.
Well, yeah, and if we look at our school systems, we're in the Kirkwood system, and it's a great system. I love Kirkwood schools. But there, you know, again, if you look at their high school, I think there is one school counselor per grade level. So that's one counselor for 400 kids. And they have other counselors that float around for emergencies and things like that. And Kirkwood does a great job. But who can keep track of 400 kids and be able to do that just for one
person? Yeah, it can't all be on the school system.
That's right.
It can't all be on the police department.
That's right.
But we saw huge failings in that and what happened in Broward County.
Sure, absolutely.
And the reason I wanted to have you in today is I think everybody needs to be aware of how complicated an issue this is from a mental health perspective.
Yep.
Such a small percentage of people would ever do something like this.
Yeah.
And we find out later that some of them never even saw a counselor.
Yeah, and if you talk about Adam
Lanza
uh-huh. and Nicholas Cruz, you know, a lot of their accounts would make one believe that they were psychotic, that they were delusional. And again, less than 1% of the country suffers from psychosis. And very few of those people become violent in this way. But, you know, I've got, and I don't want to get into this a whole other thing. I got another question for the Cruz case is I'd like to know what his toxicology report is. Because marijuana with people that are under psychosis can increase the psychosis into delusions. So I'd love to know what that looks like. I have, maybe it's out there, but I haven't seen any reports.
You know,
at this point.
I wondered that, and we also had a report earlier this week. Several people have been claiming that these psychotropic drugs that people are put on, maybe not while they're on them, but that in a lot of cases people go off of them, and
sure.
then it just exacerbates whatever the problem was.
Right. So when you talk about a bipolar population is about 3.7, a little under 4% of the population. When you talk about people that have antisocial disorder, it's another disorder that we talk a lot about when it comes up to these mass shootings and stuff. That's generally around 1%, okay? So you take those small percentages, and it's most of these people are in that, but again, it's a very small percent of that.
And it's in it's just such a subset. I mean,
that's right.
There's no way we're ever going to catch every single one of
that's right.
those problems, I don't
that's
think.
Right.
But so much more could be done.
And people that are bipolar and people that suffer from psychosis, they start taking their meds, they feel better, and they think that they can quit. And that's what we see all the time. Relapse for people with psychosis and bipolar generally is because they stop their medications.
Yeah. Well, I think you're right on the toxicology side of that. I don't know what the odds are. Let me get to Dave real quick. Dave, you're on the radio.
Hey, Mark. I don't need to be all political about this because I realize this is a serious problem that people have. But it doesn't seem long ago that none of us could say the word crazy anymore. It was not PC to do that anymore, and it was challenged and this, that, and the other. And all of a sudden, when it fits the Democrat agenda, we now are all released to go ahead and say the word crazy all the time. Even the president uses it. We all say crazy, and nobody bats an eye. I think it's very interesting that the rest of us, who just know that there's crazy people out there, always have to kowtow when it's not politically proper.
PC. Yeah, Dave, thank you for the call.
I look at those people as broken and ill.
Yeah.
It's really, they have a disease. If it's antisocial disorder, they're broken. If it's bipolar, then there's a medical disease.
Well, Brian Bauer, thank you so much with consulting with H&H Health Associates in Sunset Hills.
Thanks.
I appreciate your insight on this.
It's
a very serious subject, and we're trying to get to the root of the problem here, and I appreciate your insight. Hey, when we